Hi, I'm Brian Leversey, pastor here at Fellowship Baptist Church in Vienna, West Virginia, and we are excited to host you and your family this Easter at 11 a.m. We're going to have wonderful music, great programs for the children. We're going to be focusing on how Jesus is alive in us if we know him as our Savior. There'll be an Easter egg hunt to follow for the children, so come out and join us for Easter Sunday. Hi, I'm Brian Leversey, pastor here at Fellowship Baptist Church in Vienna, West Virginia, and we are excited to host you and your family this Easter at 11 a.m. We're going to have wonderful music, great programs for the children. We're going to be focusing on how Jesus is alive in us if we know Him as our Savior. There'll be an Easter egg hunt to follow for the children, so come out and join us for Easter Sunday.
Well, preacher, you're a pastor. Aren't you some great one? No. Just ask my children after church. I am just a man. I am just a sinner saved by grace like you are. I am just a believer filled by the Holy Spirit like you are. I happen to have a calling to be a pastor, and God has gifted me and outfitted me for that calling, but I am just a man. I am no great one, but I'm so glad I do know the great one, the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, of whom it is said, there is no greater name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Amen. And He is the great one. And any man's ministry should lift Him up as the great one. And any church's ministry should lift Him up as the great one. And any personal life's testimony should lift Him up as the great one. Here Simon was lifting himself up, proclaiming himself to be some great one. Oh man, you can't turn on the TV without seeing that spirit in our world today. How we're number one, we're great. All these talking heads, all these professionals, all these gurus, all these people we look to, all these people we slobber all over because we just want to be like them, and we hang posters and we idolize them and we think they're the best. No, there's only one that's great, and we need His Spirit in our lives. They were trapped in spiritual darkness. Notice this as we go in to verse number 10, to whom they all gave heed, from the least to the greatest, saying, this man is the great power of God. And oh, how we have shifted our focus from God, even in our country today, and we've rested on the educational systems and on the financial systems and on the professional systems, and we've made everything secular our God instead of really looking at God as being God. This is called idolatry. Anything we put in God's place and worship instead of God becomes an idol, and it is abhorrent in God's sight. Let's not idolize the world. Let's worship the one true God. Must be filled with His Spirit. Notice verse number 11, and to Him they had regard because that of long time He had bewitched them with sorceries. And this is that spiritual darkness. This is the culmination of that spiritual darkness where people are deceived, they're bewitched, they're ensnared, and they're blinded. Oh, pastor, can we get off this? Let's move on. This seems so ridiculous. This seems so fantasiful. This seems like a fable. Let's get to some real stuff. Let's talk about how our relationships can be better and how our finances can be better and how we can be more successful. No. If we don't deal with spiritual darkness, we won't find any success in life. Not that matters. Not that's eternal. And just like these people in Samaria were bound up and bewitched, it says, with these sorceries, I believe we have people in our culture today that are bound in that kind of spiritual darkness. How else can you explain what we see in our culture today? How else can you explain the mass murder of babies on a scale your mind can't even wrap around, and we will stand up and call that healthcare? I'll tell you how people have been bewitched with demonism. That is demonic from the pit of hell. It is spiritual darkness. How else can you explain the efforts to try to speak to children in a way where we're pushing an agenda on them where God's image is no longer sufficient for them, and as children, it's being promoted that they need to change their bodies or take medications or go through surgeries because they're not actually formed in the image they should be formed in, which is the image of God, male and female. How else can you explain that on the scale in which it's being promoted and the way it's being forced upon communities? How else can you explain that except that people are bewitched and ensnared and deceived on this demonic level today? Don't tell me that we don't deal with spiritual darkness. Spiritual darkness is very real. And I'm not saying this to be political, and please don't take this, but I think churches need to start speaking the truth. I'm not saying this to be political. I'm not saying it to get a rise out of the congregation. I'm saying this because it needs to be said by somebody in a place, in a platform of public notice, so that we can say things like this. How else can you explain somebody in the highest office of our land that can't, and I'm not making fun, can't legitimately put a sentence together, being paraded around by his wife, being paraded out there as a leader of a nation that is not making decisions that are good for our nation or good for our country, and everybody's saying nothing is wrong? We are under spiritual darkness today. We are under spiritual darkness today. And I would say that regardless if the person in the White House was Democrat, Republican, or Independent, what's going on is a delusion that's being passed on to people. And we need to start talking about that kind of a thing. We need to start understanding that what we're dealing with is spiritual darkness. And they're coming after our homes, and they're coming after our churches, and they're coming after our families, and they're coming after the truth, and they want to make it so that the truth isn't even recognizable anymore. And that was what was happening in Samaria as this sorcerer bewitched them and put himself up as some great one. Hey, the people of God with the Spirit of God need to confront spiritual darkness in our world. And I'm going to say this, our nation is full of spiritual darkness today. This ought not surprise us. Oh my goodness, this is point. I got to get better at getting through my first point. Notice with me real quickly, Ephesians chapter 6 and verse number 12. Very quickly, verses on the screen. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Notice with me, as Paul writes to the church of Corinth in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, we'll begin reading with verse number 3. The verses are on the screen. But if our gospel be hid, and notice the blindness, the spiritual blindness that's going to be discussed here. If our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. There is such a thing as spiritual darkness. The Samaritans were experiencing it. We are experiencing it today. But you know what? You get a lot of Christians that get down about that, and they're down in the mouth, and they're complaining, and yeah, the country, and politics, and blah, 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 school system, and blah, 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 financial system, and blah, 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 blah. And we complain, and we moan like we've already been defeated. How many of you understand we're not defeated? We have victory in the Spirit of God. He's a victorious spirit. And just as we confront spiritual darkness, we do so with spiritual light. And I want us to see that spiritual light wins. Notice as we start talking about spiritual light here in our passage, verse number 12, but when they believed Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. How many of you are glad the gospel still works? It worked at this time in Samaria. It will work in our time today. If we will have preachers, if we will have Christians that will be bold enough to actually stand up and preach the gospel and proclaim the good news of who Jesus is, people will still be saved today. Hearts can still be reached today. The light still works today. Hey, that's the whole reason Jesus came, was to bring the light of the glorious gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to this world. Notice how the gospel writer John presents this to us in his gospel, John chapter 1 and verse number 4. Notice this is speaking about the Lord Jesus Christ himself. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, the light that lighteth every man that cometh into the world. How many are glad Jesus is the light? And though the darkness comprehended it not, though he came unto his own and his own received him not, there were some who were affected by the light. How many of you understand? Jesus has his own, and he will be victorious, and his light will conquer all. And to those who did receive him, them did he give the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believed on his name. How many of you are glad the light wins? you turn on the light and the darkness goes away. That's why Jesus called his disciples to be the salt and light of the world. We find that where there's spiritual darkness, we need to take the spiritual light, just as Philip took the spiritual light to Samaria. Notice John, in John chapter number 12, we'll start reading with verse number 35. Notice what Jesus said about himself being the light. Then Jesus said unto them, yet a little while is the light with you. Walk while ye have the light, lest darkness come upon you. For he that walketh in darkness knoweth not whether he goeth. While ye have the light, believe in the light, that ye might be the children of light. These things spake Jesus and departed and did hide himself from them. And then he ascended up into heaven after his earthly ministry. And then he sent the Holy Spirit, and his indwelling makes us light as well. Light and salt in this earth. Listen, don't be defeated by the darkness that's around us. Take your light into the darkness and proclaim the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. We see also in our passage spiritual confirmation. We're looking at the victorious spirit. The victorious spirit confronts darkness. The victorious spirit brings light, and the victorious spirit brings confirmation. Notice the curious thing that's happening with Simon in our passage of scripture. Simon seemingly comes to faith in Christ. Notice with me verse 13. Then Simon himself believed also, and when he was baptized, he continued with Philip, and wondered, beholding the miracles and signs which were done. So this is all looking really good. Simon believes, he's baptized, and he even continues with Philip, supposedly connecting with him in ministry. Now we'll learn more about Simon here in just a little bit, but I want us to see what happens as the apostles learn of the conversion of people in Samaria. Drop down with me, if you would, to verse number 14. Now, when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John, who when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. I don't have a ton of time to unpack this. We're already out of time today. But this is a continuation of Jesus' instruction in Acts 1:8. First, they would give the message of the gospel in Jerusalem and all Judea. And to confirm that the message was true, Pentecost happened. The Spirit was given to the believers for the purpose of confirming the gospel and the word and the gospel ministry. Well, now they've been scattered from Jerusalem and Judea. The word got there, and now they're on their next level of ministry to Samaria. And just like the word needed to be confirmed to the Jews in Jerusalem, the word also needs to be confirmed at work in the lives of new believers in Samaria. And so something similar happens here. The apostles are called up because the apostles, much like Old Testament prophets, were the conveyors and confirmers of God's word in the Old Testament. So during this transition time, the apostles were conveyors and confirmers of God's word through his Spirit in the early church. And so Peter and John were sent up to Samaria. They laid hands on these new believers in a similar Pentecost experience happens here in Samaria, confirming that indeed these Samaritans who were hated by the Jews were converted. The same thing that happened with the Jews is now happening to the Samaritans. Now, as Peter and John are confirming the word, we find that there's a manifestation of the presence of the Spirit of God. You know, we're also supposed to confirm the word today, but we have the completed word of God to do so. Notice our instruction to confirm the word today. Notice 1 John chapter 4 and verse number 1, the verses on the screen. Notice here, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits, confirm the spirits, test the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Listen, we are responsible for confirming the word today. Whether it's this church or another church, you're listening on TV, you ought never allow somebody to open the word of God to you without you having a copy of the word of God, opening it up along with them and testing the spirits. It's your responsibility. It's your responsibility in this church. Hey, don't check your brain and your heart and your mind and your faculties at the door and come in and say, all right, Pastor Leversey, teach me. I could be wrong. I'm just a dude. Now, I study the word of God and I pray and I want to be right in the word of God, but if I'm not, I want you to tell me. If I'm not, I need to be challenged in that. If I'm not, you ought to know that, and you ought to be following along in the Word of God, because we are to test and to confirm. How many of you are glad, by the way, we have the completed Word of God to be able to do that with now? But this was the methodology here in the early church for confirming the Word and the presence of the Spirit of God amongst His people. A victorious spirit requires spiritual confirmation. Lastly, and we'll be done, we see spiritual judgment. So this man, Simon, he sees the confirming power of the Spirit of God on these new believers. And it's curious that you don't get a specific rendering of Simon receiving the Spirit of God. I'm not saying that it doesn't allude to the fact that he might have or might not have. I personally don't believe Simon was a true convert, but it doesn't mention that this one who was so interested in the power of the Spirit of God ever received it personally. But he observed it, and because he had held these people in great power, and he presented himself as such an esteemed person, he didn't want to lose that position among these people. And so as he sees this power conferred by these apostles, notice his response to it. Verse 18, and when Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands, the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money, saying, give me also this power that on whomsoever I lay hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost. And I believe we see here a similar spirit in Simon that we saw in Judas. You'll remember that Judas also appeared to be a true disciple of Jesus. He seemingly believed on Jesus and he followed Jesus in his ministry. But there was a telling thing that happened. And it's not just Judas's betrayal, but even before Judas's betrayal, there was a telling thing that happened that showed Judas's heart. You'll recall with me that during Jesus' ministry, there was a woman who came to Jesus, and to show worship to Jesus, she broke open this vial of expensive ointment and poured it on Jesus' feet. And Judas rebuked Jesus and the disciples for this. He said, could we not have taken this precious ointment and sold it for a bunch of money and then given the money to the poor? But then the verse continues and it says this, Judas did not say this because he cared for the poor, but because he held the bag and he was a thief and he was a robber. The motivation for Judas was money, even in Judas's betrayal of Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. You recall that Ananias and Sapphira, they got bound up in lying concerning their ministry with money. Hey, listen, these churches that abuse money, these churches that abuse finances, these pastors and televangelists and people who fleece God's people for their own advantage, let me just tell you something. God takes this very seriously. That is not a spirit from God. That is a spirit from Satan himself. It's the spirit of Judas. And now we find that Simon, who I believe was not a true convert, was more interested in preserving his hold over these people by purchasing the power of the Holy Spirit than he was about really encountering the Holy Spirit of God. And so he's judged. Notice what Peter tells him in verse number 22. Repent therefore of this thy wickedness and pray God if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee, for I perceive that thou art in the gall of bitterness. Why was Simon bitter? He was bitter because he was being replaced as the esteemed one. Now Jesus was going to be the esteemed one. Now the Spirit of God was going to be the esteemed one. And he had bitterness about it in his heart. We see the judgment of the Spirit of God. Listen, there was a promise that the Spirit of God would help us to be discerning and help us to judge correctly. Notice again the words of John in John chapter number 16 and verse number 7. The verses are on the screen. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. This is Jesus speaking. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. And when he is come, notice this, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of what? Judgment. For sin, because they believe not on me. For righteousness, because I go to my Father, and ye see me no more. Of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged. The spirit of this world is judged. Hey, listen, that's what the church needs to do today. The church needs to take the truth of the Word of God. The church needs to walk right into the darkness of this world. The church needs to bring the light of the Spirit of God to this world. And the church needs to use discernment and judgment that is healthy both for the church and for the world. How many believe we need to get back to God again? We need to get back to the true power and leading and discernment of His Spirit again. We need to get back to preaching convicting messages that show us our sinfulness and show us the direction that we need to repent and bring us along in our righteousness as we grow in the Lord Jesus Christ. We need the victorious Spirit of God. We see a victorious Spirit through the ministry of Philip. to the ministry of John and Peter? Is he seen in your life? Let's not play games with God. Let's understand the purpose and power of his Spirit in our lives.